Richard Shepp has spent much of his young life in hospitals.
Some people may look at life and say, you know, that he slows my life down. He enhances my life. Are you kidding me?
That's how it's always been with the Shepp family. They look for the good, even when it's hard to find.
Richard came into the world at 25 weeks.
We had triplets. The other two, you know, passed away at night, and then Richard was the only one left.
Shortly after birth, he developed a brain bleed, and that resulted with the hydrocephalus. They explained it to me as extra fluid in the brain and that he would need the shunt, and I thought, okay, so we get the shunt, we move on.
Typically, a shunt relieves the pressure in the brain, but in Richard's case, it didn't work.
Richard had a very complicated case of hydrocephalus.
Parts of his brain that were supposed to be draining were loculated, which meant like there were little walls built up. Fluid would get trapped between two sets of walls. That made things very, very, very difficult.
We were having surgeries back to back, sometimes days apart, sometimes 24 hours apart.
Every day was a struggle. Every day was a battle. We had hospitals that would turn Richard away.
They really needed a lot more expertise.
They found a specialist at the University of Wisconsin Hospital in Madison, 2 hours from their hometown of Little Chute, Wisconsin.
They came to see Benny Iskandar, who was just a phenomenal neurosurgeon and one of my mentors.
We had bags packed at all times, and we just get in the car, and the only thing on our mind was getting Richard to the hospital.
Richard pretty much lived here at UW for a good 3 years.
Over the long weeks and years, the Shepp family developed a special relationship with Dr. Iskandar's resident, Dr. Josh Meadow.
There was something very unique about him. He was very driven.
He was always asking questions.
I knew he would keep a good eye out for Richard. We spent a lot of hours together.
At times, Richard even played the role of a young Dr. Meadow.
We did a little videotape from home.
We just thought that would be fun because, you know, he would like that. He'd think that'd be funny.
If you see a patient like Richard and meet a family like ours, run.
The friendship triggered an unexpected chain of events. For years, Dr. Meadow watched as Richard struggled because there was no easy way to tell if pressure was building up in his brain.
All of a sudden, he's just laying there, lethargic, throwing up.
You couldn't tell. You know, is he sick because there's something going on with the drainage system in his head, or is he sick because he has the flu?
The only way to check Richard's brain pressure was with surgery or by tapping his shunt.
Sticking a needle into your son or daughter's head where they're screaming, they're awake.
Richard would just cry, all done, all done, all done.
It was amazing how much he would let you do. And his parents would talk him through everything. Richard was willing to try to do anything that would make them happy. Yeah, we went through a lot.
Literally, we've left the hospital, been maybe halfway home, and he'd be throwing up. We'd be turning around, coming back.
It was just a never-ending struggle for him.
At some point, you say, we can't keep doing this.
What they didn't realize was that Dr. Meadow was saying the same thing.
Looking at Richard over and over and over again, I think, my God, there's got to be a better way.
We're almost all done, honey.
It dawned on me, if I had a way of measuring the pressure in his head, would make it a lot easier than having to tap the shunt, check the flow, go to the OR. One night I decided I was going to make an intracranial pressure monitor.
A device that could be implanted in the brain. Dr. Meadow was in a unique position to make it happen.
I was going to be a computer engineer.
He actually got a degree in biomechanics before deciding to become a neurosurgeon.
There was no better computer than the human brain.
He always was working on different things, and he was always trying to develop things.
It's one of those things where you think to yourself, hey, look, I can make something. I know I could build it. And so I'm going to build a proof of concept. But it was as big as a table.
Fortunately, Dr. Meadow is also an assistant professor in biomedical engineering, so he knew exactly where to turn for help in refining his invention.
I've solved problems in the past for people who work in medicine.
He says, well, you know what, we really could make this smaller.
We build a tiny little piece out of silicon. Just two coils that gets pushed by pressure.
A handheld scanner would be passed over the head to detect and display the internal pressure.
You could actually swipe the thing over their head.
If you've ever gone through a locked door by putting some card up against it, it's the same kind of thing. Your card and the door will talk to each other. What we implant in the brain will talk to this reader on the outside.
You would know then that the pressures were correct.
It would be huge, because you would know in advance if there was a pressure problem in the child's head. With respect to hydrocephalus, most people would agree this is the holy grail.
An easy and painless way to gather critical information. It makes so much sense, you wonder why such a device doesn't already exist.
Little kids have little pocketbooks, and so it's really kind of hard to drive a major corporation to build a device that they're not sure they're going to be able to reclaim money back on. Nobody wants to take the risk.
If this thing works as well as we hope it will, people will demand it and things will happen more rapidly.
They got a signal.
Richard has improved so much in recent years, he probably won't need the device when it's finally ready for the market. For the Shep family, though, it's enough reward to know Richard played a part in something that will help other children.
I get goosebumps talking about it. It was just overwhelming.
I don't know if you can describe in words how much pain Richard went through. If this works and it's right, this would be a miracle.
Richard never did anything to deserve all that he got. And given a bum deal, he still persevered.
He gives a lot of people hope for never giving up.
He lights up a room. He loves you. And if it wasn't for Dr. Meadow, Dr. Iskandar, and all the staff here at UW, he wouldn't be like he is.
Everybody always thinks, why me? I ask, why me too? Why give me such a special human being? It's been a long road, but it's been a good road. It really has.
And the road took another interesting turn a few years ago.
After Richard was 10 years old, things had, calmed down. And we had a little baby girl. I never would have had that opportunity if it wasn't for what they had done for Richard. There was no question of what name we wanted.
Madison.
We decided to name her Madison after everything and everybody here.
Because of what this university has done for us.
Madison is still always part and will always be part of our family.
Every time we hear that word, Madison, it makes us smile. Because this university has made our life wonderful. I am absolutely the luckiest guy in the world. We got two great things. We got great friendship with the university, and we got great friendship and love with our son. I'll tell you what, we won. And if anybody thinks in life that we lost because of what we went through, we did. We won.